had Christ in us last week. So this week we're going to do us in Christ. So before I begin, I've had some mixed emotions about me speaking today. Somebody said yay, and somebody said, wait, let me get a cup of coffee. So we will give praise to God and rebuke the enemy is what we will do. So. Just kidding. We live in a world that desensitizes us to a lot of things. We're desensitized to a lot of bad things, but we also are desensitized to a lot of good things. The message last week was a very deeply spiritual message, and yet it's very easy just to say, oh yeah, Christ is in us. Of course, we already knew that. That's what you call being desensitized to something that is good. If you don't allow that word to go all the way in and nourish that part of your soul and touch that part of your soul that gives you life, that gives you the impetus to go forward and the strength and the wisdom to go forward with the Christ in you, then actually we have lost part of that message. As a matter of fact, we have a lot of times when we have messages like that, the hardest message to preach is one where everybody says, matter of fact, Christy's brother, was that your brother that came here one time and preached the message on the love of God? And we're like, God loves us, duh. But that was a great message. I don't know how he got that. When he got through, I realized, wait a minute, God loves us. So if you can get desensitized to some of the things that happen and some of the truths that are there, then you lose the power of them. So it's a very good strategy of the enemy to desensitize you to the things that you think you already know. So I want to just preface this by saying, not only did you truly understand Christ in us, but today we don't truly understand what it means for us to be in Christ. So what we do, the Bible calls preaching, the matter of fact, it refers to us as the foolishness of preaching. So I've got a little foolishness for you today, and I'm going to talk to you about us being in Christ. Now, when you think about this, you think, okay, so what's the big deal? Why Christ in us, us in Christ? Why are you so intent on delineating between what we're in or what's in us? Why are these prepositions so important? Well, I'm glad you asked that question, because I want you to turn, we're going to open up Colossians 1:27 that Pastor T read last week, and we're going to read one more verse in it. It's Colossians 1:27. Can you put that scripture up there for me? Colossians 1:27. Okay. To them God has chosen to make known among the Gentiles the glorious riches of this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. There was a time when the church heard that scripture and they were in awe of it. It was a stand up and cheer type revelation. Matter of fact, there was a time to us that it was a stand up and cheer type revelation. Be careful that we don't get so mature, and I put that in quotes because it's not maturity when all of a sudden the simple truths of the gospel don't excite you. That's not maturity, that's deception. Don't get so mature that you're not excited by Jesus. We're all excited about something, so let's be careful that we're not tricked into thinking, oh well, you know, try to tell me something that'll excite me. If you're not excited by the gospel, the glorious gospel of Jesus Christ, then you don't. There's nothing else that we can tell you. There is no other message. Amen. This is the message that is the reason that you're alive. We sang a song today that says, because you live, I live. We sing that song, but if we really believed it, we'd think, oh my God, we'd have no life if it wasn't for your life. If you had failed, if Jesus had failed his mission, there would be no hope. We'd be without hope in the whole world. Think about that. Think about where you were when Jesus found you and pulled you up out of that mess that you were in. Think about where you were and how hopeless it was. And then in some of our cases, think about the times that he pulled you out of the stuff that you got into after you got pulled out of that stuff. Then you'll get excited about this hope of glory. The next scripture is, he is the one we proclaim, admonishing and teaching everyone with all wisdom, so that we may present everyone fully mature or complete in Christ. So now we've got Christ in you. Now we've got you in Christ. So what is the difference there? Okay, I'm actually going to need some help to explain this to you. So I'm going to ask Pastor T and the First Lady, Miss Christie, to come up and their two kids. And we're going to do, I'm going to show you by a presentation what that means. Jake always loves to come up when I preach, so that's why I ask him up. But right? Yes. Yes. Okay, now what I need for you guys to do is I want y'all to kneel down right here. Just kneel down. Well, actually sort of face me this way like this. Okay, and then I want y'all to come over here, and I want you to put your hands on them while they're kneeling. And I want to show you that Christ in us is a spiritual DNA. He is actually transferring his DNA into us. Does anybody agree with that? Yeah. Okay, that's what happens when it says Christ in you. It is a spiritual DNA. So because I started to get Pastor T, I realized God has a feminine side, which is another story later. But they both, because I realized Pastor T did not do this by himself.
Correct. That is correct.
Christy said amen whether y'all did or not. But matter of fact, she thought she did it by herself after one time there. But they, what they have done is they have passed their DNA into them, and there is nothing that can reverse that. Nobody can get their DNA out of them. Aren't you glad? Nobody can steal what God has placed in you.
Amen.
That is permanent. It is their very... God has actually infused his DNA into us. That's just an amazing truth. Well, you heard it last week. Still ought to know it. Now, I want you guys to stand up. And I want you guys to kneel down. But I don't want you to put your hands on them. I want you to put your hands on them still. Get closer, because this is what happens. For God to allow us to come into his life, he had to humble himself as a man, Jesus Christ, and allow us into his life. When they put their DNA into them, that was permanent, but that did not allow them a right to have their life in them. When they put their DNA into them, they could go into any part of their life because that's who they were. They were kids, and they could go into their life. Let me use an example, and if you weren't here last week, I apologize because I don't have time to explain it. But when Pastor T and Miss Christie put their DNA into Jake and Zach, it gave them the right to go into their white carpet room. But Zach and Jake did not have the right to go into their white carpet room unless they allow it. They dictate whether they can come back the other way. They can have these two guys and ship them off somewhere, and they're not even part of their life at all. But because they choose to take them, they're saying, you can be part of my life. You can know what I'm thinking. Matter of fact, as much as I'm in you, I'm going to let you be in me. As much as I have permanently placed my DNA in you, I am going to permanently allow you to come into the white carpet room of my life, which is what? The Holy of Holies. When Jesus died on the cross and was raised from the dead, it gave us access to the Holy of Holies by his own choice. That was not earned. We didn't get that because we had his spiritual DNA. We got that because he allowed us in and he invited us to be in Christ. So this is not something, that's why I didn't want them to lay their hands back that way. We don't decide that. Everything that we have is because of his choice. Does that make sense? Do you see the difference there? Okay, y'all can go. Thank you very much. Now, I'm going to draw you a picture that might make it even clearer. Because if I don't draw a picture, somebody's always upset because my artwork is so good. Somebody's like, man, I came all the way here to hear you preach and there's no artwork. Okay, Christ in us. That's what we preached last week, Christ in us. Now we are in Christ. So that's what that looks like in that kind of picture. Now, what I want to ask you, and this was brought up earlier in the sermon, but I'll use this color, is our identity, who was it that mentioned identity in Christ? Was that you, Pastor T, a while ago? Probably you. Okay. Amy said a while ago, it's not what we do, it's who we are. Many times I've had people come in for counseling and I've said, everything that you do is not who you are. Think about that just a minute. Everything that you do is not who you are. Thank God. Absolutely, thank God. I've done things and I look back later and I thought, who was that? Who was that masked man that did that? I couldn't even remember thinking that in my brain. So this right here is what we do. This is who we are. Amen. This is what we do. And this is who we are.
Amen.
Never ever identify yourself by what you do, by your past failures, by your past successes, by your wounds, by the lies that were spoken over you or by the lies that were spoken to you in your own heart. Do not identify yourself that way. Identify yourself this way. I think I have a scripture. Is that next scripture up? Is Exodus? Do I have that Exodus scripture? This is a good identity question. You know, they teach you in Bible school not to preach shotgun sermons. You know what a shotgun sermon is? A shotgun sermon is you just hit it and it just spreads out everywhere. It doesn't really have a point. It just goes out over everywhere. Well, that's what we're going to do today, what they told us not to do. Matter of fact, we're lucky to have a title at all. Exodus chapter 3, Moses said to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? Now, who am I is a really good identity question, right? I think that's down to the basics. Who am I that I should do that? And so God explained to him who he was, and this is what he said. I will be with you, and this will be a sign to you that it's I who have sent you when you brought the people out of Egypt. You'll worship God on this mountain. Where's the who am I answer? It's there. Let me say it this way. Moses said to God, who am I? And God said, you're somebody that I'm with. That's who we are. We are so tangled up in this part of our lives, especially this part of our lives. We're so tangled up in that, and we find our identity whether we're a preacher or a teacher or a candlestick maker or what we have done or what we feel like we can do till we have forgotten that who we really are is somebody that God is with, somebody that is in us, and somebody that has allowed us to be inside of Him. That's who we are. That's not the Sunday part of us. That's not the worship part of us. That's the reality part of us. That's who we are in every situation. You know, we have a world of superheroes, and there's always, I don't know if y'all like superhero movies or not, but somebody likes them because they still make them. And isn't it wonderful? What they do in this thing is they just make stuff harder and harder and harder and harder, and then all of a sudden the superhero rips his shirt off and everything is there. I want to tell you today, in Christ, you are that superhero. Amen. When you show up with Christ in you and you in Christ, you have the ability to bring life in death, to bring light in darkness, to bring hope where there is no hope, to bring love in a world full of hate. Don't you wish that we had a world full of hate so you could go out there and show the love of Christ in it? Well, guess what? You're in luck. It's there. We have what it takes to show that. What Jesus did in allowing us into the Holy of Holies is what is supposed to make us understand who we are. Christ in us changes our DNA. It changes the way we think. But what happens along the way is we hear this lie that says, well, you're not good at that. You're not good at speaking, or you're not good at that. Or you start talking to somebody about the Lord and they say, well, you know what? They know that you failed. Well, that's good. I want them to know that I failed because they failed. And I want them to know that failure is not the end of the road. The end of the road ends at the cross. Amen. And that is a success that you cannot do on your own. Somehow we have gotten into this thing that we're trying to get people to join this because it's a great organization and we want you to come on and, you know, come on and join us in what it is. And we've forgotten that what we have to offer is life to everyone, no matter who they are. I was talking to Cole the other day, and he's involved in this skateboard thing. I need to tell you about that, Jimmy, because you may be too old for that now, but I don't think so. But he got in it because it's an opportunity to share Christ with a different culture, because skateboard people are just different kind of people. They wear different clothes, they talk different ways, they have no understanding about safety, they've just got a whole different culture that's in there. I mean, literally, Cole's had like 4 or 5 broken bones because of his skateboarding, which made me wonder why did you keep doing that? After the first 2 or 3, why did you keep doing that? Didn't that make sense? That was going to do something. But it's that culture. It's the thing that they love. It's what happens. But he was talking to this guy about Christ, and this was the phrase that he said that I just loved. He said, no matter what we do, you always seem to come right back to that answer. You always come back to Christ is the answer. Amen. See, that's what happens to somebody that truly understands who they are in Christ. You always come back to that. There is no other hope. There's no other source. That is the source. We think about people that have giftings and stuff like that. Do you realize that most people have more identity in their gifting than they do when they're in God in them, Christ in them? It's like, this is what God's called me to do. Well, guess what? It's the gift that He gave you, and it's really not all that important. It's really not. I can still remember the day when God told me that He was not impressed with my preaching. That was not a good conversation. And I tried to explain to him how important that gift was, and that it was that he was the one that gave it to me. Isn't it amazing? I was going to use that for leverage. You gave me this, and he said, I know, and I can take it away, or I don't have to use it at all. I thought, well, that's not a good argument. Now I want to show you something in the scripture about this Christ in us. And there's two scriptures here we're going to have. I wish we had a lot of time. This is Ephesians 1:13 and Genesis 7:16. It says, you were included in Christ when you heard the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation. When you believed, you were marked in Him with a seal. You were sealed by the Holy Spirit. Does anybody know what that means? Have you ever thought about it, what it meant to be sealed by the Holy Spirit? I didn't think so. Genesis 7:16, the animals going in were male and female of every living thing as God had commanded Noah. Then the Lord shut him in. Another translation, it says, the Lord sealed him in. You see, the ark is Christ. It was the only salvation for the entire world in that time. And guess what? It's the only salvation for the entire world today. We have been sealed in the ark of salvation. Don't you like that? Isn't that a wonderful thing? This is not just something that got planted in us. We got in the boat and God sealed it up. Noah didn't seal it up. None of his bunch sealed it up. God sealed it up. It was the only way. If God doesn't seal it up, the seal doesn't work. The Holy Spirit has sealed you up into Christ. Do you understand the intimacy when God breathed breath into man? How much more intimate can you get than that? God wants to be intimate with His creation. And after the fall, the thing that the fall took away more than anything else was the intimacy of the Creator with His creation. But as far back as Genesis 7, or actually before that, actually happened with that first skin that God killed, the skin that He gave to Adam and Eve, there was a death and a redemptive process. But right here we see that not only is there a redemptive process, but there's a seal that goes on that says, you know what, I'm going to seal you into this, and you are safe. You're in the ark. Can you imagine? Out of all of creation, just those few little people in that ark were the only people that were safe. They were sealed in there. I want you to know that you've been sealed into God by the Holy Spirit. Now, what is this supposed to do? What is all this supposed to do to you? Well, I think it's supposed to change the way that you think. Now, I've got too many scriptures here, but I do want to skip on down. Can you skip to number 6? I feel like I'm on the radio. Get us a soundbite number 6. Well, you don't know what number it is, do you? It's Colossians chapter 3. Wow. Well, let's read it. You died, and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. One of the lowest moments in my life is when I went to God and I explained to Him that I was a failure, which was not a revelation to God, but it was a confession out of my own heart. And you see, everybody's different about how they deal with failures. Some of us run and hide. Some of us do a lot of different things. But some of us sort of bargain with God. Lord, I'm a failure. Now, a lot of times when you ask God a question, you already have an idea of what you'd like for Him to say. Most of my prayers, I already know what I'd like for Him to say. I'm not looking for an answer. You know, I don't want some answer out there. I have an answer that I'd like you to pick. Matter of fact, oftentimes when I pray, I use this multiple choice with God. Maybe I should say not multiple choice, just one choice. So I go to God and I say, Lord, I'm just one big failure. Now, what do you think I'm trying to get God to say? No, not you. Look at all the good that you've done. If you cannot claim the failures that you've done. If you don't want to live in those, then you can't claim the good that you've done. That's why I'm saying I don't want either one of them. What we'd like to do is we want to count our good things that we've done, but we want to God just to say, well, just forget about the bad stuff. But this is how he answered me. And I cannot tell you, and I hear people tell stories and I think, I wonder if that's even true or not. But this is actually a true story, and it changed my entire life. It changed the way I looked at the gospel. Because he told me, he said, you are a failure. Which at first was definitely not one of my, that wasn't even in the multiple choice. But he said, you are a failure, but don't be afraid. I'm not. And your life is hidden in me.
Wow. Amen.
Now I'm going to tell you something. That was springs in the desert for me. Because I didn't feel like God even knew where I was. I was so far off. Don't worry about it. You're a failure. Doesn't matter because your life is hidden with me. I didn't fail. I made it all the way. And when I made it, you were in me. You were in me when I was crucified. I'm crucified with Christ. You were in me when I was raised from the dead. When we were baptized into death, we were raised in him. All of those are in Christ. We were with him the whole way. He said, you were with me the whole way, and I made it. He came along and he said, every bit of the law has to be fulfilled. Well, I can't fulfill any of it. We always joke about whoever that was that came to me one time and said, I think I broke some commandment. I'm thinking, well, I don't even know what that is. I didn't know we were supposed to memorize those. But I said, I hate to tell you, but you broke the first commandment. Because you don't love the Lord your God with everything you have. You cannot. It's impossible to do that. But Jesus fulfilled it all. And he said, I fulfilled it, and when I fulfilled it, you were in me.
Amen.
That's how this happens. Do y'all see how important that is? That he allowed us to be in him and just not him in us. There really is a distinction there. Now, I want to tell you something that has always been something I want us to talk about in this. I'll try to close with this. I'm not even sure I got open yet. That's the good thing about shotgun sermons. It doesn't matter. I've used this term before, but it fits in here really well. Hybrid Christianity. Has anybody ever heard that phrase? Have I used that before? Okay. Well, I'm going to use it again. Thank you very much. Hybrid Christianity says that we work as hard as we can until we can no longer do it anymore, and then we allow Jesus to finish the rest of the way. That's hybrid Christianity. Try as hard as you can, and then when you can't do anything else, then let Jesus come along and do the rest. Now you say, well, I would never say that. Well, I know you'd never say it, but you do it. We all do it. We all have this thing inside of us that says, well, I was telling somebody about the grace of God the other day, and they said, well, am I just supposed to just sit down and quit living? I said, no, you're supposed to stand up and start living now in Christ. That's the big difference. Grace doesn't mean not to do anything. Grace means now you can finally realize that you were no good right there. It was only the Christ in you there that made the difference. It's not where he starts making it right there. There is no good thing that dwells in your flesh. You're just like the Apostle Paul. There's nothing good. We're so eager to find something that makes us important, that makes us of value. Well, let me tell you what makes you of value. Christ lives inside of you, and he gave you the opportunity to live inside of him. That's great. That's the greatest value that there is. You don't have to find your value in the fact that I'm able to do this or I'm able to do that, or I haven't committed as many sins as I used to do, or now I'm able to hold my breath a little bit longer than I used to could. I want you to understand that even at zero, you could do nothing. Jesus said, without my Father, I can do nothing. Jesus, the Savior, realized his need for God. And we're like, well, you know what? Well, I've been to church so much, I know how to do a lot of stuff. I'm not going to really need you out here till somewhere out here where the bill, I can't pay, if I get where I can't pay the bills and my wife is mad at me and, you know, something happened, then I'm going to need you there. Meanwhile, I'm okay. That's the deception that keeps you from being victorious in your life. If your victory is determined by whether or not you're successful in what you're doing, if you're being a good Christian, which is a phrase that is not even in the Bible, or I'm going to try to be a better Christian, which is a phrase that sure ain't in the Bible. Matter of fact, it came right out of hell. Because trying to be a better Christian just means that you're going to take less and less of Christ and more of you, which is exactly backwards from the Scripture. So, are we just supposed to quit? No, we're supposed to start with a life of Christ. Every day realize I'm nothing without Christ, but guess what? Christ lives in me and I'm in Christ, so there is nothing that I cannot do. I am the guy that can show up and I'll be the superhero, but nobody will know who I am because the things that I do won't matter. It's who I am in Christ that matters. And they'll say, who was that masked man? And they'll say, I don't know who he was, but he was in Christ and Christ was in him. That's the legacy that we leave behind. One of those Christian songs is, I want people to see you in me. Let them hear you when I speak. That's a really, really humble prayer. But you know what? That is a very hard thing to live out. Because we want to find purpose and meaning in our actions. But we sure don't want to wait around and find anything wrong there. Now, I've got an example here for you. You can buy, first thing I thought about was a vacuum cleaner. I don't know why. I've never used one of those, so I don't know what those are, but you can buy the best vacuum cleaner that's got all sorts of little tricks that it does. Now they've got them where they vacuum in the corner, and you know, they're always advertising this. You ever seen the one where it holds up the bowling ball? And I'm thinking, I told Susie, I says, no need us to get one of those, we don't even bowl. So. But there's a lot of little tricks that they do, but if you unpack that thing, you get it home and unpack it, and you just start pushing it around, you'll think, well, this doesn't work. It's not doing all the tricks. Because it doesn't work till you plug it in. We want to do as much as we can without plugging in. We want to try to accomplish all that we can without plugging in. And you know what? That's just a dirty, rotten trick from hell. We need to realize, you need to plug in at point zero every day and say, I'm nothing. I went to see a patient one time. I think this is starting to close. I went to see a patient and she told me, this was early on when I first started doing this, and I was the only chaplain we had in about four counties, and they called me one day to go to Bonifay. I got a patient that's dying and I need you to go. And I said, well, I'm at the golf course. Just one of those freak accidents that had actually coincided with a time that I was at the golf course. I'll need to go home, take a shower. No, you don't have time. You may not get here anyway. So I run off sweaty in my golf outfit and golf shoes. And I go and sit by this lady's bed. And everybody's frantic, trying to do everything, and she was in the throes of death, and she looked at me, and she said, Preacher, she said, am I just supposed to give up? Y'all, that's a hard question. My first thought was, I wish I'd been trained better to answer that question. My second thought was, I have Christ in me, and I'm in Christ. So I ripped off my shirt and waited for God to say something. And I told her, I said, ma'am, God is way too big to ever give up. But he's big enough that you can let go. I didn't realize what a profound statement that was in life and death. That she didn't need to worry about anything. She could just relax and let go. But that did not mean giving up. So a few weeks later, I went up to Church of Joy to preach, and I preached a message titled Let Go But Don't Give Up. And so I was standing up there, and I was going to try to give an example, and I won't do this, Jake, I won't call you back up here again, but this is something I did at the other church to let you know that I'm not just picking on you. So I said, I need two people up here, and I picked them out of the audience. I picked a lady to be a person that was drowning. And then there was a young man there, and I picked him and called him up. And I said, now I've got two people up here on the stage. Now this lady is going to act like she's drowning, and she's going to be, you know, waving her hands and kicking her feet and screaming. I said, this guy's going to be the lifeguard, at which point everybody laughed. And I said, why are you laughing? They said, because he's a lifeguard. And I said, well, that's all the more reason you need to listen to the man of God. I picked him out of the audience. So I said, this woman is in distress, and she's fighting with everything that she has. I said, when you get to her, what do you want her to do? I asked the lifeguard, what do you want her to do? And he said, I want her just to quit doing everything and let me rescue her. Now I want to tell you something. We all get in situations where we need rescuing. When God shows up and you quit flailing your arms, that doesn't mean you gave up. That means you know that the rescuer has arrived. Amen. And I want to tell you something. The rescuer has arrived a long time ago in your life and mine. And God is too big to ever give up, but he's big enough that you can let go and trust in this great promise that we've heard for the last 2 weeks about our intimacy with our Savior. Everything that the devil did, matter of fact, the scripture says in 1 John, or I think it's 1 John, that Jesus came to destroy the works of the devil. Well, what are the works of the devil? To divide us from our Creator. And Jesus came to make sure that that division was over. And it was not only redeemed, but sealed. Sealed by the Holy Spirit of God that says, this is something they can never take my DNA away, and I've got you sealed inside of here in this ark, and it can never be taken away. Those are some serious promises from God. Well, let's pray. Lord, we're thankful for your promises. We're more thankful that you're able to keep them. A lot of people give us promises, but they don't have what it takes to keep them. But the things that you've spoken will come to pass. You can just think it, and it will happen. So our hope is in you. Our hope is in the rescuer that has come to us and said, relax, I got this. I have you. And Lord, you know our failures. We know them. But your price was enough. The price that you paid was enough. So as we look to you today, we look to you with great gratitude, but may we walk out of here with great boldness into a world that is so full of hate and darkness and division. May we walk out of here realizing that we have everything inside of us, that we will leave a trail of the love of God. We'll leave a trail of the light of God. We'll leave a trail of the hope that there is in God. And we don't have to know anything or anybody know our name, because our life is hidden in you. We want you to get that glory, Father, through Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you for staying awake, and you are dismissed.